Welcome to the first video lecture in the Central Eastern Europe politics, society, culture class. A few words about how to use these video lectures. Treat them as regular class lectures, which means that you should take notes, pay attention just like you would be in class, because the information you get in the video lectures is not the same as the information you have in the books. And you are expected to know this information that you get through the lectures as well as those that we get from other materials, just like in a class lecture, right? So take notes just like you would do in a classroom and do pay attention. Again, the information that you get in different sources is complementary, it does not replace each other. So, that being said, today I will talk a little bit about generally the area, the region that we will study, especially since some of you have not had any exposure to it, which is fine, as long as you will have in this course, and you will get quickly into learning about it. So today will be about the region in general, as it is today, in order to then start already this week, but next week, to look into how it developed, how we got here, what are the foundations, how did it result into the result that we know today. So, what is then Central and Eastern Europe, right? Even the name itself, you see, it said Central and Eastern. I mean, it seems that there are different regions. What is Central Europe, which is even more, perhaps, vague for some of you than Eastern Europe, right? Well, Central and Eastern Europe, here's a map of Europe, and these maps are on canvas, so even if you can't really, you know, see clearly on this map in the video lecture because of the limitations of video taping, you can follow on your canvas software, okay, where all of these maps are posted. So do that while, you know, listening to the lecture or afterwards. So this is first a map of Europe, right? Just to have a picture, right? So we have Europe, and we usually use, in common parlance perhaps, or in the news, you hear about Western Europe, right? Or Europe and Eastern Europe. These are the two major words that you hear. But this is clearly a misnomer. This is why the course is called Central and Eastern Europe. It's a misnomer, it's a mistake in a way, right? Because it and which comes from the reality of the of communism, right? Of those years between 1945, 46 and 1989, so only about 45 years, which divided the continent along ideological lines. But as the article from Kundera's, Milan Kundera's The Tragedy of Central Europe, which you should also, you know, read today, as that article makes it clear, this division is, first of all, false, artificial, and, well, it does not correspond with the truth of the situation. Now, of course, after 1989, the situation changed again, right, as it was before 1989, before 1945, before communism. But we kind of got stuck with these names. Now, later on, you also had Donald Rumsfeld talking about, during the Iraq intervention, talking about the new Europe versus old Europe. Again, nonsense, right? Because many of these states, actually in Central and Eastern Europe, are actually older than, much, much older than the states in Western Europe. So, let's try then to look at these realities that are more lasting than this and that regime, right? And to understand this region from a more grounded, more historical perspective. So, here's Europe, right? And we usually talk about Western Europe. Sometimes, mistakenly again, people would assume that Central Europe is actually Germany. Well, that's not. That's Western Europe. So what are we talking about then about when we talk about Central and Eastern Europe? So it's basically the area that broadly corresponds with what used to be the Austro-Hungarian Empire, was situated between the West, between Germany, Italy and so on, and the East, mostly represented by either the Russian Empire or the Ottoman Empire. So this area, plus some countries today. So let's name them, and that will make it clear. So in this course, Central and Eastern Europe is the region south of the Baltic area, east of Germany, and west of what used to be the Soviet Union and Turkey. So Central Europe would correspond with Poland, the largest country in the area, and actually one of the largest in Europe, both in terms of territory and size of population. So Poland, then Czech Republic and Slovakia, right, which used to be one state during communism, Czechoslovakia, actually after 1989, but then in the 90s again became two different states. Then Austria, which used to be the dominant force in the area, which we will not examine closely, but only in as much as it was influential at certain points in history, but it will not be part of the core topic of our examination. Then you have Hungary, right? This will be, you know, the core of, so we start from north to south, right? And then further going south, you have the countries that used to be part of former Yugoslavia. Slovenia, Croatia, Bosnia and Herzegovina, Serbia, Montenegro, Kosovo, right? And here we got to the countries of former Yugoslavia. So you see, the heart of the core of what used to be the Austro-Hungarian Empire is this area here, which includes Austria, Czech Republic, Slovakia, a part of Poland, all of Hungary, a part of Romania actually, Slovenia and Croatia, and a part of Bosnia and Herzegovina. This used to be the Austro-Hungarian Empire. This is the core, this is the heart. And the reason why we call it Central Europe, all this area, and you know, as when we do the historical overview, right, basically the overview of the development of how this area came about and how it developed into what we know today, you will understand this better. So don't worry if you don't remember everything right now. So this is the heart of Central Europe, and basically what's east of it we could consider to be Eastern Europe. Now when we talk about Yugoslavia, this area also is also called the Balkans, right, the Balkans, because the Balkan mountains are there. So we talk about Western Balkans containing most of former Yugoslavia, and then Eastern Balkans, and that contains Bulgaria, Albania, Greece is not included there, and Turkey is kind of the boundary. So we talked about the countries of former Yugoslavia, that's kind of the south, Slovenia, Croatia, Bosnia and Herzegovina, Serbia, Montenegro, the most recent countries, Kosovo, and actually Macedonia, right? Macedonia. This was all part of the Yugoslavia. And then there's also Albania and Bulgaria, and north of it is Romania. Okay, so Central Europe, Eastern Europe, so to speak, and the Balkans. You see, these are overlapping categories. I'm going to take them one by one, but I wanted to run through the countries which you also have in the syllabus, and also, you know, so they're listed there. So from this, why do we treat this as one area? That would be a question, right? Well, in this course, because politically and in terms of their society and in terms of their culture, there are tremendous commonalities due to their common shared history. Now, these countries are very different, right? And Milan Kundera mentions in the article that this region can be characterized as the greatest possible variety on the smallest possible territory. And that's true. Between Vienna and Budapest, the capital of Austria and Hungary, if you take the train, it's only 2.5 hours. From Budapest to Bratislava, the capital of Slovakia, is basically an hour or so. So Slovenia is only, you know, 2 million people, right? But it's very different from, I mean, significantly different from Croatia, very different from Hungary, very different from Austria, with commonalities. So this is why Kundera refers to this area as a Europe in miniature. And that's why for American students sometimes, and some of you took my European Union class, it's hard to understand what is Europe, in the sense of what is Europe, what makes Europe Europe, right? What is the common identity? Because being European doesn't mean that you are not Polish, you're not German, you're not Italian. It's not an identity other than. It's not an identity that replaces the national identity. Right? Being American means that you kind of give up your ethnic identity. You say, well, I'm of Irish ancestry. It doesn't really mean much. Because you don't speak Celtic at home. You don't speak German at home. You don't speak... You speak English, right? That's your ancestry. It's the melting pot. But this is not the melting pot. And Europe as such is not the melting pot. And Kundera mentions that Central Europe, he refers to it, but I can say Central Eastern Europe, is a European miniature because you have a diversity, you have very different cultures. And even within one country, within Romania, if you go to the here, just 550 kilometers, 30 miles north, you are in a different culture, even if they speak the same language. Because the food, the habits are different. If you go further up north, it changes even more. If you go, you know, the west, south, east of Romania are very different. Culturally, you go to the villages, they dress differently, and so on. So it, truly, truly, the largest possible variety in the smallest possible territory. But however, within this large variety, there are strong commonalities. There is a strong common culture. There is a strong common culture. Not language, but there is a strong common culture that comes from a shared historical experience, giving rise to, and also from a history of intersecting influences. A history in which all of these, you know, these boundaries are very recent. In much of history, I mean, these have changed continuously. For example, the best example I usually give is that a person born here, let's say in 1918, who would be 90 years old, or whatever, 97 years old, right? Here, throughout their lives, let's say 1915, let's make that person 100 years old, right? There are such persons. I don't know if that in that region, but in the world, right? 100 years old. In their lives, a person born here has been an Austrian citizen, a Hungarian citizen, a Soviet citizen, a Ukrainian citizen, maybe a Polish citizen, and that person never left their village. This old lady never left her village in her life and yet has changed citizenship. Why? Because borders have fluctuated. Political borders in this area do not constitute identity. What constitutes identity, and this is where Kundera's article is poignant, is culture. It's culture in the sense of this shared identity, this shared language perhaps, the way you look at the world, the way you experience the world, the way you behave, the way you live your life. This is why I can talk about a Central Europe that covers different countries today. It used to be part of one empire, which is not the same as the modern state, the Austro-Hungarian Empire. And they are part of the same culture because if you go to Timișoara here, to Budapest here, to Kikinda here, to Ljubljana in Slovenia, to Vienna or to Bratislava or even to Prague, you will see buildings that look alike. And if you are just popped there, you know, from the helicopter, blindfolded and open your eyes, you're not always sure where you are until you start seeing signs and different languages because the place looks the same. It's very similar because they are part of the same culture. You go to families in these different places of what used to be the Austro-Hungarian Empire and you see that a middle-class family has the same life rhythm in all these places. They distribute the rooms similarly in an apartment. The role of different rooms in an apartment is similar because they are part, the way they live their life is still the same. Right? And they respect the same values. Now, you learn more of this hopefully as we go on. But this gives you a sense how there is a shared culture notwithstanding different languages. Right? And that's the culture of Central Europe. Then there is an Eastern European, this is why I separate Central and Eastern, because there is an Eastern European experience or influence that is slightly different, or significantly different, right? Because of a different historical experience. So, you know, people from what used to be Central Europe here, you know, someone from Western Romania lives differently than someone from the east, northeastern part of Romania, of what is today Romania. Because that used to be Eastern Europe. And why am I talking about Central Europe and Eastern Europe, and what is the dividing line? Well, this is why also this area of Central and Eastern Europe can be treated together. Because as a whole, this area has always been at the crossroads of things, at the crossroads of clashing of clashing political actors and of clashing cultural factors. From back to the Roman Empire, when it divided between the Western Roman Empire and the Eastern Roman Empire, well, yes, this is the fault line. Later on, Christianity, which shaped Europe, the Christian culture, which shaped Europe, a culture rooted in Christian values, a worldview, outview, and so on, the division within, the major division within Christianity was between Western Christianity and Eastern Christianity. That happens in 1054. But guess what? Most of the states in this area are founded around the year 1000. Hungary was founded as a state in the year 1000. So talk about New Europe, right? In the year 1000. And it's at that point that Christianity has this major division. But understand this not as a division of religion that you just do inside and whatever nonsense. Religion understood as a way of living your life as a society, as the constitution of a society, right? The way in which the values that we hold as important that shape the way in which we behave. And that was the, as Kundera points out, right? That was the basis on which the European societies functioned throughout history until modernity, when the modern nation state was invented. We will discuss more about this further. But in the Middle Ages, for example, Europe didn't have like these stable boundaries that we know today, for sure. Germany only came about in 1870. First time in history. Didn't Germans exist before? Yes, but Germany is a state. Italy as a state was 1870 as well. Not never before in history. Boundaries fluctuate. But what was common, and they could fluctuate because what was common was this shared constitution, this shared way of looking at the world. And it didn't matter if you were Christian in the sense of devout or going to church or whatever or not. Right? Nobody asks you if you subscribe to the philosophical foundations of the constitution that you inhabit. Have you ever read John Locke? Then how can you say you're American? Well, the constitution is founded in many ways in the ideas of Locke and others, right? And you subscribe to them even without consciously knowing them. That's what I mean by constitution. That's what I mean by constitution, by the philosophical assumptions. But this is how you can have variety and yet a shared outlook, right? So in that major division between East and West, which happened in 1054, was the division between Western Christianity, which is the Catholic Church, this is before Reformation, and the Eastern Orthodox Church. Based on the division of the Roman Empire into the Western Roman Empire and Eastern Roman Empire. Eastern Roman Empire, because of these distances at that point, weren't just easily traversable, and it wasn't easy to be covered. The Christian Church that used to be one, right, one part of one, you know, again, body of thought and body of practice to a large degree, to a significant degree, then it divides because of centuries of geographical separation into Eastern Orthodox and Western, which Catholic, right, based in Rome. And that was a deep cultural division because, a deep cultural division. And guess where does that fault line come through? Right here. Because this is where the division happened. So, a major fault line, a major cultural fault line. Then you have the rise of Islam, which pushes this way. And then the establishment of the Ottoman Empire, which will cover most of the Balkans and take, you know, subjugate, put under their control, influence, let's put it this way, parts of Romania and then even part of Hungary. So, pushing this way, you have Islam, right? That too will be a dividing line, right? The push towards the Ottoman Empire with a culture based on Islam and Western Europe, which would be mostly Catholic and then later Protestant. So again, a dividing line. And you see that being lived out in Bosnia and Herzegovina. And you're saying, but this is history, who cares? 1990s. What is the biggest conflict in Europe after World War II? The wars in former Yugoslavia. Where were they the bloodiest? In Bosnia and Herzegovina. Why? Because this is where all this mix of identities is most prevalent. You have Catholics, Orthodox, and Muslims, well, which then becomes, that religious identity becomes associated with different national identities. And in a world in which national identity is something so big that, oh, I am something, I need to have my own state. I'm American, I need to have my own state. I'm not, it doesn't matter, I need to have my own state, right? That's where this becomes a source, and that's why this becomes a source of tremendous conflict, because they, these Orthodox Catholic Muslims, they will actually be understood as well. Croatian, which are Catholic, Serb, which is Orthodox, and Muslim, which is Bosniak. Because guess what? Well, you understand again more when you when it's history. But I'm just giving you examples of how this is not history. This is present. This is present. Thousands of people died because of these conflicts of in which each tried to carve their own statehood. And guess what? Their national identity was based on. I mean, the national not identity was based on, but the way you could differentiate who's Serb, who's Croatian, who's Bosnian, because they spoke basically the same language, was that they were of different culture, meaning different religion. So it wasn't a religious conflict, but it was their identity. This is how you knew who is what. Just like the conflicts in Northern Ireland. Who is English, who is Irish? They all speak English. Well, in Northern Ireland, you know who is Protestant, who is Catholic, and that kind of gives you the difference. So, fault lines between the East and the West. And politically, who were the major actors? Austria for most of history, Russia for most of history. Then in the 20th century, Germany and Russia. So basically, a West where the German or Austrian influence and the French influence has been the most powerful, and an East where the Russian and the Ottoman influence has been most powerful. And guess what? And here's where they all clash. Right. So politically, they have always been at the crossroads. All of these countries have defined their history, their national history, as a history of defending Europe. This is why Kundera talks about the director of the news agency, the Hungarian news agency, saying that we're dying for Hungary and for Europe. Because throughout their history, they understood their history, you know, all their history is sprinkled with battling the Ottomans. And this is rewritten, the reasons were different, right? But this is understood backwards or rewritten as we were battling the Ottomans and stopping and thus protecting Europe. So there's this idea of a mission, of a cultural civilizational mission in which they have been at the borderlands. This is why Kundera talks about, you know, this idea, this Palatsky, leader in the 19th century, writing about the fact that, you know, we need the Austro-Hungarian Empire to protect us from the expansion of Russia. Well, guess what? The same thing, that expansion happened, and in the 20th century, what happens in the 20th century? After the fall of the Austro-Hungarian Empire, you have these newly found states fighting themselves between a Nazi Germany and the Soviet Russia led by Stalin. So on the left hand, you have a maniac ready to kill everyone, and on the right hand, you have a maniac ready to kill everyone. Choose one. And both of them gigantic in terms of power, impact, and so on. So choose one. So that's another important thing about this region, that it has a common history of tremendous cultural richness, of common culture, but also tremendous variety within that common culture, just like Europe. And of having been always at the crossroads of things. Now, why again do I talk about the Central Europe and Eastern Europe? Is because the Central Europe has been mostly associated with, on this dividing line, fell on the side of the West. Meaning, mostly these countries are Catholic or Protestant, historically have been, and have been associated with, you know, the Renaissance, have lived through the cultural life of the West, while these countries have mostly been, well, not countries, this area, because in Romania there is a dividing line that goes through it, in this area, these areas have fallen under the influence of either Russian influence or Ottoman influence, which might have been political control or cultural and so on. But all of them looked towards the West as part of their identity. But most of these are Orthodox, for example, today, and most of this area is Catholic, Protestant, even if they don't practice the religion, but in terms of, again, the cultural roots and so on. So, on the, I will post a document today where I'm going to list how these linguistic and religious divisions actually form. But I'm also going to explain it briefly so that you have an idea of each country. And you're expected from now on to not make confusions. Do not tell me by any chance, don't ever tell me that Romanians are Slavic people. Because that means you have not paid attention and you have no clue. Right? Not allowed, not permissible. Okay, so let's go through each of these countries and kind of give you a sense of where we are. So Poland, the language is Slavic, but again, read Kundera, has nothing to do with Russia. Not in history, not in their culture ever. Okay? They have always been one of the major enemies of, and kind of fought historically, the Russian Empire and the Tsars and so on, even conquered. So Poland, mostly Catholic, actually very Catholic, Slavic language. Czech Republic, Slavic, divided mostly between Catholic and Protestant. Usually, its history, it has usually been associated with the Germany and Austria. Slovakia, also Slavic language, very similar to Czech, this is what it used to be, Czechoslovakia, but still different. They never had statehood of their own, they mostly have been part of the Hungarian state. Poland, Czech Republic, Slovakia are what we would call the Northern Slavs. Originally there were Slavic tribes that came and settled in many parts of this area, but some of them stayed in the north and some went to the south. So these are the Northern Slavs. They have commonalities because most of them fall within the Catholic slash Protestant area of Reformation, Protestant, Lutheran, right? Area of influence. That's around here. Poland and Czech Republic Poland has had a long-lasting statehood. Czech Republic less so, but a very clear identity. Slovakia never had statehood until 1918. Then we move to the center. Now there's Austria, which is Germanic, but not German, right? Germanic language, right? Switzerland, Germanic language, even Netherlands is a German dialect, so don't confuse languages with statehood or identity. They might have things in common or might not. So this has been the major power under the Habsburgs for hundreds and hundreds of years in the area, especially after in the 18th, 19th, and early 20th century. And it was the core of what was the Austro-Hungarian Empire, which covered most of Central Europe. One of the greatest cultural centers in the history of the world. Especially in Vienna, but as a whole. Kundera mentioned. We will not deal with Austria more very specifically, again, I said, except for those historical moments when it's important. Because after the Austro-Hungarian Empire, it kind of gets, let me put it this way, Austria did not share that sort of a divisive influence, that sort of an experience, historical experience, of being at the crossroads of conflicting forces as a small society, which is common for peace. Okay, Hungary, not Slavic, do not make this mistake, they speak Hungarian, Magyar, which is a language that has no relatives. Its closest relative, which is very far, has nothing in common with it if you hear them, not even grammatically, is Finnish. So Finland, yeah, right, but that's just on paper. So there's no relatives to Hungarian language. Actually, its grammar is actually linked to Korean grammar. So there you have it. But another language. The language is completely unique. So a very specific. It used to be, has an old statehood, used to be one of the great powers, not only in this area, but in Europe. As you see, now it's a small state, but there are complications related to that. Then perhaps the next one to talk about would be Romania, which again, not Slavic. Romania is called Romania from Roman because they claim an ancestry that is marked Roman, meaning the Roman Empire. The Roman Empire conquered this area and defeated the local populations, the Dacians, but the language is Latin. So it's very, very close to Italian, Romanian language, and Spanish and French and Portuguese and so on. But very, very close to Italian. This is why today the largest minority immigrant population in Italy is Romanian. Because it's very easy to learn the language. So Latin, but part of it has been under sort of part of Central Europe, part of Western influence, this part, Transylvania. This part has been mostly under Soviet, Slavic, Russian influence. This part mostly under Ottoman influence. But all of them are Eastern Orthodox. Most of the Romanians are Eastern Orthodox, with Catholics on the Western part, right? Hungary Catholic and Protestant, Austria mostly Catholic and some Protestant. So you see, Central Europe, Eastern Europe, but the dividing line kind of goes Transylvania, the western part of Romania, is kind of part of Central Europe. But anyway, Romania are mostly Latin, so it's Latin-based language. And it's kind of the boundary between Central and Eastern Europe falls through Romania in many ways. Then let's go south to what we can call the Balkans, the Western Balkans, Eastern Balkans. But this is the countries of the former Yugoslavia. These are the Southern Slavs up to here, right? We call them Southern Slavs. They're very different, but they have a common Slavic language. And because they have this common Slavic language, in the south they were called Yugoslavia, which means Southern Slavs. That's what it means. Yugo is south, Slavia, well, the country of the Slavs. This was an attempt, an experiment after 1918. They were never had a common country in history before, or actually after. And the wars that broke apart Yugoslavia shows you how weak these links actually were. Why? Because today the two states that are westmost are Slovenia and Croatia. They're very different from Serbia, Montenegro, who are in the east. Catholic, Western associated, Slovenia never had a state. It has always been associated with Austria, and it has been part of that Austrian culture. You go to Slovenia, you feel like you're in Austria. So it's very different. So this whole Yugoslavia thing that was carved out in the 20th century was an experiment, which this is why it failed, because they never had a shared, you know, identity. Besides this related language. But think New Zealand and the United States. Not the same country, same language, right? Yes, I think so. Bosnia and Herzegovina, I just mentioned, this is where all these divisions, complicated by all these divisions, because today we carved out this something called Bosnia and Herzegovina, which never existed as a state. Bosnia existed, Herzegovina is something different in history, you'll see. But the point is that the population is Slavic, but because they all speak common similar Slavic dialects, but historically on the west they have been a part of a different culture and mostly Catholic, in the east part of a different culture, different historical experience, and mostly Eastern Orthodox. And in Bosnia, some of these Slavs during the Ottoman occupation took up the Islamic religion, so they're Muslims. So suddenly you have all those who are Croatian, who are Catholic, are Croatians, all those who are Orthodox are Serbians, and all those who are Muslim are Bosniaks. Right? Why? Because we need to define ourselves. And these three different cultures. But this division kind of falls right through Bosnia and Herzegovina, so that's what you have in Bosnia and Herzegovina. You see how it has happened. That Serbia used to be an important actor in the 20th century, not before. Serbia is on the other side of this divide. It has been always Eastern Orthodox. This Eastern Orthodox identity has been part of the core national identity of Serbia. Montenegro is a very small state that usually has been associated with Serbia, recently declared independence after the 2000s. Kosovo is the most recent state, one of the most recent states in the world. It never existed, and it's kind of a solution instead of, because we ran out of other solutions. It's mostly populated by Albanians. It used to be part of Serbia and Yugoslavia, but because it's mostly populated by Albanians, after the wars of former Yugoslavia, they also wanted their own thing. But why not part of Albania? Because they didn't want a war between Albania and Serbia. So Kosovo is sort of this Albanian enclave, mostly Albanian enclave, which Serbians have always claimed as their ancestral homeland. And we've seen history why. So this is why there were wars here. Then you have Macedonia, which is the last country that used to be part of former Yugoslavia. Mostly Slavic, again Eastern Orthodox, all of these are Eastern Orthodox. But again, a very new state established in the end of the 1990s. And never existed in history. And you will see why, because most of this area was under Ottoman occupation. Then you have Bulgaria, which is speak a Slavic language, but if you take it ethnically, the tribes that settled there, they were not Slavic tribes. There are many Slavic tribes that settled in the north, in the south, but Bulgarians themselves were not Slavic. They just took up this language, and are also Eastern Orthodox. So Bulgaria. And finally, Albania, which will not be much. Albania speaks not Slavic, speak Albanian. Historically, because of Ottoman occupation, many of them have been Muslim. But also, a good portion of them are Catholic, some are Orthodox. Again, this is an old civilization, the Albanian one, goes back to the Thracians. So one of the original cultures in the area, actually. Also, one of some of the biggest fans of the United States in the world. Indeed, it's a Muslim country. Actually, not really, because during communism it was the regime imposed atheism. So they banned all churches, all religions. So most of them are non-believers. But nominally, at least, a majority of Muslim country, which the main boulevard in front of their parliament is called George W. Bush Boulevard. Big fans of the US because of the US intervention in the wars of Yugoslavia that allowed for Kosovo to become independent, which is populated most by Albanians. But it's another trait of this region is that these borders do not correspond with ethnic or cultural borders. Hungarians live here, 2 million live here, or 1.5 million live here, many live here. Why? Because the boundaries of the Hungarian state used to be much larger. But when the boundaries of Hungarian state were much larger, then you had a large population of other ethnicities, Romanians, Slovaks, and so on and so on. You'll see this when you do the historical review. But there's another trait here that ethnic and cultural boundaries do not correspond with state boundaries. In some cases, like Hungary, which has been carved as this small state now, there is more homogeneous simply because they left out all the areas where there are intersections. But understand that the modern state has been invented in Western Europe and spread throughout the world, but basically nowhere else in the world except for parts of Western Europe. Does this idea correspond that a state is purely populated by those of that nation or ethnicity? Hence the many wars fought to clean the state from other ethnicities. So, a quick review then. You have Northern Slavic, mostly, let's call them westward leaning, right? Catholic, Occidental, you know, westward leaning, Poland, Czech, Slovakia, Austria we will not deal much, Hungary, non-Slavic, Romania, Latin, Hungary, Catholic, Protestant, Romania, Eastern Orthodox, countries of former Yugoslavia, westward leaning, you know, mostly part of Western culture are Slovenia and Croatia, Bosnia and Herzegovina falls right in the dividing line, Serbia, Montenegro, and Macedonia are, again, part of former Yugoslavia, Slavic, Southern Slavs, but Eastern Orthodox, Bulgaria, speak a Slavic language, Eastern Orthodox, Kosovo, Albanian, and Albania, well, Albania. And that's Central Eastern Europe that we deal with. Now, from all this area, because of this diversity, we'll only focus on a few key countries, because I want you to understand this diversity, but to understand the focuses, right? To understand the commonalities, right? Why is this, which make this area so fascinating, because their historical and political experience has been so unique, and therefore their politics today is different, right? Because they have lived a different history, they look at politics differently, their cultural roots create a different sort of politics, a very unique area in that sense. A laboratory, as I said in the syllabus, for many interesting themes. So we will focus on, of all these countries, on Poland and the Czech Republic from the north, on Hungary from the center, and on Romania, which is in between the center and eastern Europe. And from former Yugoslavia, mostly we'll focus on Slovenia, Croatia, and Bosnia and Herzegovina. Now, at a different point in our discussion, some other countries will pop up, like Serbia, when we talk about Yugoslavia, like Austria, when we talk about the Habsburg Empire, and so on. So you will have different other countries, basically a short soft spotlight on them. But kind of as a common theme from Northern Slavs, the Poland, Czech Republic, westward, meaning Hungary in the center, unique language, special history, the westward leaning Southern Slavs, Slovenia and Croatia, Bosnia and Herzegovina is such a fascinating country at the dividing, country today, never existed, at the dividing lines of all these influences, and Romania. These will be the points of our focus. And again, what we're going to try to draw out of these is commonalities. So this is a map of Europe, but I also posted a map of the region itself, so you can see it more clearly. Central Europe here, the Balkans, and perhaps you can also say Eastern Europe here. Okay? So a map of Central and Eastern Europe, which typically is called here Eastern Europe. Then I gave you two links to a zoomable map of Europe and a zoomable map of Central and Eastern Europe, so you can get more closely and look at them. But I want you to study these maps and understand the countries and understand their differences and their different cultures. And finally, I posted a map of the Danube. Why did I post a map of the Danube? Because in many ways the Danube is not just a metaphor, but concretely the thing that links this whole area. Because the Danube starts in Eastern Germany, part of Western Germany, but the part that used to be associated with Austria, it starts here, goes through Austria, goes to Slovakia, goes to Hungary, goes through Croatia, Serbia, and the borders of Romania and Bulgaria, and goes to the Black Sea. And it's in many ways, this is the river that connects the entire region. And if you want to have a fun vacation, you know, take a cruise through, you know, the river. And stop and get off. In fact, one of the famous books about Central Europe is called Danube by Claudio Magris. It was one of the seminal, important books that renewed the interest on this specific area of Central Europe in the 1980s. It's one of my favorite books about this subject. Okay, so that's why I posted the map for today. So, as resources besides this video lecture and some written information I'm going to post, also you can use the from the Frucht ebook. For each of these countries, there is an introductory section. Now that introductory section deals with other things, economy, but those are also fascinating. But in that introductory section, it gives you a sense of each of these countries. Religion, size, culture, and so on. So if, you know, to clarify and to have a reference of what I just explained, you can, and you are suggested to use those introductory sections from all these countries in the Frucht ebook. Okay, thank you.